Hello and welcome to day 6 of Babcock University's annual week of prayer. It's good to know that you are right there on the other end. And just as you're looking up to God for blessings, for testimonies, He definitely will meet you at the point of your needs. And so sit back and relax as we serve you something really interesting yet again today from the servant of God, Pastor Gemini Getta. But before you get to listen to the servant of God, we will be serving you some real good soulful music. And please don't forget to stay tuned to the very end of the program for the form that you have to fill. And so right now, we will be taking the opening prayer. You're welcome once again.
Dear viewers, it's time to pray. Wherever you are, I want you to bow your head as you seek the Lord in prayer for today's message. Today is the 6th day of the week of prayer. Shall we pray? Dear Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your kindness. We thank you for your love and favor over our lives. We thank you for how far you've used the preacher all through the past 5 days. We've come to the 6th day. We pray that the message today will bless us and it will reach us at the point of our needs. We ask that if there is any with any form of ailment or the other, that Father divine, you will heal. We pray if there is anybody seeking and looking up to you for one thing or the other, Father divine, we pray that you provide. At the end of this week of prayer, we ask and we pray earnestly that you will satisfy us and our cause will fill up. Thank you, dear Father, because we will experience your salvation again and again. Thank you because you came to die for our sins. We commit the preacher into your hands, break the bread through him, and watch over him and his family. In Jesus' name we've prayed. Amen.
Jesus, peace are we the land. God, you do me well, you. That's why I say.
Praise the Lord. And so right now we will be getting straight into the sermon for today because of our time. And I hope you are ready to be blessed, because trust me right now, I am so ready to be blessed by the servant of God through the sermon that he will be presenting today, titled The Portrait of the Savior. The Portrait of the Savior.
Good day and welcome to this wonderful Bible lecture series for the week of prayer and spiritual emphasis. It's been a great time in God's Word, and we've been looking at the theme, Grace Galore. Grace Galore, a theme which is inspired by Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 to 10, which says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith. And that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." This text teaches us six things about our salvation. We are saved by grace. We are saved through faith. We are saved as a gift. We are saved not by works. We are saved for God, and we are saved unto good works. It's been an exciting journey in God's Word, and today we are continuing this journey in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 2 to 8. And I invite you now, if you will, to turn your Bibles to Ephesians chapter number 2. And our particular emphasis is on verse number 10. Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 10. And as you flip the pages of your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, permit me to affirm my belief in the Bible as the Word of God. I believe in the supremacy of the Bible. I believe that the Bible is the ultimate authority. I also believe in the sufficiency of the Bible, that it is sufficient to make one wise unto salvation. I believe in the summation of the Bible. I believe that all scripture comprising the Old and New Testaments and 66 books only is God's inspired word. Let us now read Ephesians chapter 2, verse number 10 with this understanding. The Bible says, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." Based on this text, our topic today is the portrait of the Savior. The portrait of the Savior. Let's ask the Lord to lead us as we study his word. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the blessing of Bible study. We ask that the Holy Spirit, who inspired your word in its entirety, will illuminate Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, and give us insight for living. And as it has pleased you to use a frail and a feeble vessel as myself, I do not ask for mighty words of human wisdom to move the audience. All I ask now, O God, is that humanity will diminish and divinity will dominate, that you will speak to us pointedly, powerfully, and personally in the name of Jesus. God's people say, Amen. The portrait of the Savior. We have completed Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6. Verse 8, and Ephesians chapter 2, verse 9. And we are in the last verse of our passage, which is verse number 10 of Ephesians chapter 2. And this interesting verse of scripture really begins the second part of the book of Ephesians. Let me explain. You see, the book of Ephesians divides into two parts. There is a portion of the book that focuses on doctrines. that focuses on theology. And there is a portion of the book that really focuses on what I'll call ethics, the application of theology. Now, interestingly, this miniature, you know, presentation of Paul's doctrine of justification by faith also presents to us those two aspects. The first aspect of Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9 seem to be concerned with doctrines, with theology. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of works, not of yourselves, not of works, lest any man should boast. So that particular portion, verses 8 and 9, are concerned with theology. It is the doctrine of justification by faith. It is a doctrine of salvation by grace. Now, verse number 10 has to do with the ethical part of it. It has to do with the application. It has to do with the, you know, the workings of the Holy Spirit in the life of the believer to conform his or her character to that of the Lord Jesus Christ. So as we analyze chapter, 2, verse number 10, we will focus on the following points. We'll look at the master's masterpiece. We'll look at the making of the masterpiece. And finally, the manner or practice or conduct of the masterpiece. We'll look at the first two in this lecture, the master's masterpiece and the making of the masterpiece. Now come with me to the text. The master's masterpiece. Look at chapter 2, verse number 10. The Bible says, "For we are his workmanship." For we are his workmanship. Again, the word "for" occurs here. Remember when we studied chapter 2, verse 8, that verse begins with "for." For by grace you have been saved. That "for" is indicating the purpose of salvation. The purpose of salvation. And based on chapter 2, verse 7, it is clear that God has saved us that we might be portrayed, or that we might be displayed as the trophies of his grace, as the trophies of his sovereign and his saving love. Now, we see chapter 2, verse number 10, he uses "for" again. And at this point, "for" is actually suggesting the purpose of life. The purpose of life. In other words, the purpose of the saved. Why is the believer saved? Remember, we said the purpose number one is to display us as trophies of his grace. But purpose number two, God saved us to demonstrate the triumph of his grace. The triumph of his grace. In other words, God's purpose for the saved, God's purpose for the saved is to demonstrate the triumph of his grace in designing a cherished work of act, which is relationship, and workers of good actions, which has to do with right living. So relationship and right living are the two things that are clearly demonstrated here in verse number 10. Now, notice with me, brothers and sisters, what is said by the servant of the Lord. Okay, Ellen White in the book Heaven. The servant of the Lord says, "In that day, the redeemed will shine forth in the glory of the Father and the Son. The angels, touching their golden harps, will welcome the King and his trophies of victory." Who are his trophies of victory? Those who have been washed and made white in the blood of the Lamb. A song of triumph will peal forth, filling all heaven. Christ has conquered. He enters the heavenly courts accompanied by his redeemed ones, the witnesses that his mission of suffering and sacrifice has not been in vain. The King and his trophies of victory. Hallelujah! We are the trophies of the victorious, substitutionary, vicarious death of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary. Yes, my friend, we see the products of this project, this masterpiece of God. He says, for we are. Now, wait a minute. Who is now the workmanship of God? He says, we are. Do you remember when we studied Ephesians chapter 2, in verses 1 to 3, the Bible describes who we were outside of Christ, who we were without Christ. Now he says, we are his workmanship. After saying, by grace we have been saved. Now he says, we are his workmanship. Now, what are we? His workmanship. But what were we? Brothers and sisters, we were dead in trespasses and sins. We were walking according to the course of this world. We were living according to the will of Satan. We were living in the lust of the flesh and mind. We were by nature the children of wrath. We were destined to die. But look at us now. We are the objects of his grace, and we have transitioned from merely being the objects of his grace to becoming the products of his salvation. Grace has saved us. Grace has transformed us. Now we are the products of the grace of God. Hallelujah. Now, friends, I want you to also notice something. The proprietor of this product. The proprietor of this product. Look at the text. It says, for we are his. We are his workmanship. Who's the owner of this workmanship? We are his workmanship. What that means is that, brothers and sisters, we are the workmanship of God. His, this pronoun is placed first in the Greek. When you look at the Greek, you know, it is placed first for emphasis. In the Greek, it is his, for we are workmanship. His, for we are workmanship. That is a literal order of the word in the Greek. The position of the pronoun at the beginning of the sentence renders it emphatic. You see, the possessive pronoun his indicates ownership and sole proprietorship. Yes, sole proprietorship. My brothers and sisters, God is the proprietor of the product. In other words, God owns us. We are his workmanship. In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20, the Bible says, or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God? And take note of this, you are not your own, for you were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's, or which are owned by God. So yes, God owns us by creation and by redemption. But there is something else in the text I want you to see. The Bible says, for we are his workmanship. Workmanship? Yes, that's what we are. We are his workmanship. The word workmanship that is used in this text is a very interesting word. It is poema. It's actually from poema to make with the ma, which is the result of that making. It is the source of our English word poem. Poem. It is the source of that word. Thus, the word means something that is composed. It means something that is constructed, something that is made, that which is manufactured, a product, a thing that is made, a design that is produced by an artisan. Listen, my friend, poem meant any work of art. It could mean a statue, a song, an architecture, a poem, or a painting. We are his workmanship. Oh, my dear friend, God has made us his fine work of art. We are his masterpiece. We have been skillfully, we have been artfully created in Christ Jesus. We are his poem. We are his poem. My dear friend, we are the master's masterpiece. We are the master's masterpiece. We are the priority of God. We are the priority of God. We are the priority of God. In other words, my dear friend, we are the crowning work of God's creative work. The Bible says in Romans chapter 1, verse 20, "For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things which are made." And the Bible uses the word there, made, which is poem. Which are made. In Psalm 143, verse number 5, the Bible says, "I remember the days of old. I meditate on all your works. I muse on the work of your hands." Friends, we are, in fact, in the LXS, the Septuagint, that word "ma" is used again in that particular text, 143, verse number 5. We are the crowning work of God's creative workmanship, the priority of the product. Friends, I want you to know that God created this world in 6 literal days. He spoke and all else came into being. He created firmament. He created the waters. He created the land. He created the animals. And the Bible says he created man. When he was creating man, he said, "Let us make man in our own image and after our likeness." God made man in his own image to be his masterpiece, the crowning work of his creative authority. Yes, the Bible is right in Psalm 139, verse 14, when it says, "I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well." Yes, God created us. God made us. We are the crowning work of his creative act. Michelangelo was once asked what he was doing as he chipped away at a shapeless rock. He replied, "I am liberating an angel from this stone." That's what God is doing with us. We are under construction. We are in the hands of the great maker, the ultimate sculptor who created the universe out of nothing. Yes, he has never yet thrown away a rock. He has never yet thrown away a rock on which he has begun a master work. His tools are Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit, his word and the preaching of the word of God. And he is every day making us. He is transforming us. And the Bible says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. He is a new creation. All things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. My dear friend, creation was grand, but the new creation is grander. To bring a world out of nothing was great. To restore a world from chaos is greater. At the first creation, God saw all that he had made, and it was good. At the new creation, God experiences even a deeper emotional joy. We have been saved, and as the song says, "I am saved and I am free. Praise the Lord, I'm free, no longer bound, no more chains holding me. My soul is resting. Oh, what a blessing. Praise the Lord, hallelujah, I'm free." The making of the masterpiece. Come with me again to the text. Verse number 10. The Bible says, "We are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus." Created in Christ Jesus. So first we look at the master's masterpiece. But now we want to see the making of the masterpiece. The text says we are his workmanship. Created. Created. What's the meaning of that? Created. Created means to bring something into existence or to call into being. Created. The Greeks use theizo to describe the founding of a place, a city, a colony. points to saved sinners as new creations in Christ. Oh, my dear friend, His Spirit now called into existence eternal life. Tizo, I want you to understand that the aorist tense points to this specific creative act as having taken place at a point in time in the past. But the result is that the believers are now no longer their own. They are now the created of the Lord God Almighty. They are the workmanship of God. But now they are doubly His, created first in His image and then recreated based on His work of redemption. Hallelujah! Let us live out the truth before a dying world. That we now have Christ in us, and He has recreated us. He has redeemed us. He has restored us. The Bible says in Ezekiel chapter 36, verses 26 and 27, I will give you a new heart, and a new spirit I will put in within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. He says, and I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. This is what God has promised. A new creation. A new creation. The making of the masterpiece. The making of the product. But what about the makeup? What is the substance that this is made up of? Listen, the Bible says, we are His workmanship created. That is the making of the product, the making of this masterpiece. But what is the substance that we are made up of? The Bible says in chapter 2, verse 10 of Ephesians, we are His workmanship created in Christ Jesus. In Christ Jesus. Oh, friends, the makeup of this product is the character of the product. What has Christ made us in? We are His workmanship, created in what? In Christ Jesus. In Christ Jesus. In Christus Jesus. In Christ Jesus. We have been created in the Lord, in Him. Occurred 164 times in the letters of Paul alone. The phrase in Christ or is equal is used about 27 times by Paul in Ephesians alone. To be in Christ does not mean to be inside Christ. No, it does not mean to be inside Christ as a tools is in a box or as our clothes are in the closet. But it means to be organically united with Jesus. To be organically united with Jesus as a limb is to the body and the branch is to the tree. It is a personal relationship with Christ that is in the distinctive mark of His authentic followers. Listen, brothers and sisters, the makeup of this workmanship, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Yes, that's who we are. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 20 to 24, but you have not so learned Christ, if indeed you have heard Him and have been taught by Him, as the truth is in Jesus. He says that you put off concerning your former conduct, the old man, which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lust. 23 says, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Be renewed in the spirit of your mind. He continues, and that you put on the new man, which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. He says in Colossians chapter 3, verse 10, and have put on the new man who has been renewed in knowledge according to the image of Him who created him. What is the makeup of this product? What is the makeup of this new creation? It is the character of Jesus. Being renewed is in the present tense. It means constantly being renewed. That is called sanctification. Listen, my friend. We are called to abide in Jesus. We are called to walk in the righteousness of Jesus. The question is our acceptance based on God's justifying righteousness or sanctifying righteousness or both? Yes, both. We are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 30, but of him you are in Christ Jesus, who became, take note of this, he became for us wisdom from God and righteousness, which is justification, and sanctification, and redemption. Redemption. Let me say this, as John Calvin puts it, Christ cannot be divided into parts. So the two things, justification and sanctification, which we perceive to be united together in him, are inseparable. God wants to justify those who are willing to be sanctified by him. As he declares you righteous, he wants to make you righteous. He wants to make you into the character of his dear son, Jesus Christ. He wants you to be like him. He wants you to live like him. He wants you to talk like him. He wants you to walk like him. In the words of that songwriter, Lord, I want to be a Christian in my heart. Lord, I want to be a Christian in my heart. In my heart. In my heart. Lord, I want to be a Christian in my heart. Will you allow Jesus Christ to send his Holy Spirit to abide in your heart, that he will make you like Jesus? If that is your desire today, bow your head as we pray. Oh, Father in heaven, we thank you for the portrait of the Savior, for the masterpiece, the poem of the Savior. Beautiful work of poetry, beautiful work of art by the sculptor himself. Eternal God, as you make us into your image, as you conform our character to yours, as you daily work in us through the ministry of the Holy Spirit, may the fruit of the Spirit be evident in our lives. We thank you to this end in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
Wow, I believe that you are blessed just as much as I have been blessed with the Word of God this evening. And also, you have a better and a clearer glimpse of the portraits of Jesus. I hope you appreciate his work in your life. And that will be a wrap on our broadcast this evening, saying thank you so much for listening in. Thank you so much for viewing this evening. And don't forget to subscribe and also drop your comment. And at the end of this video, there is going to be a form for you to fill out. Please do fill out. And if you have any questions, feel free to drop it in the comment section below and someone will answer your questions. Thank you so much. And do make sure you stay tuned as we continue our journey tomorrow. Grace galore. Take care.